Okay, so let's start here up on the hip. We notice we got a nice round muscle here. This is the middle gluteal muscle. And then just behind it or caudal to it is going to be the superficial gluteal. And if we have a superficial gluteal and a middle gluteal, we must also have a... Yes, that's right. If we transect this and reflect it, we have the deep gluteal muscle in here. Okay, so all of these muscles are going to pull this way towards the ilium, and so they're going to abduct the limb. Okay, the middle gluteal and superficial gluteal are also going to extend the hip, but primarily we're going to group these guys as abductors of the limb. Okay, so a problem we have with our middle gluteal is because of its attachment on the ilium, it's going to cause medial rotation. And so we need our lateral rotators, which are sitting in here, attaching in here, to rotate it laterally so that it counters that medial rotation, and then we get smooth movement like that. So our lateral rotators of the hip include the internal obturator, whose tendon comes across here and divides the gemelli muscles. Then from the ventral surface, we have the external obturator muscle and the quadratus femoris muscle. All of these muscles are going to attach in here, so the internal obturator comes over here, external obturator comes up this way, and then the gemelli come over here as well, and then the quadratus femoris goes from here to here, and so all of these are going to cause lateral rotation, which will counter the medial rotation from the middle gluteal muscle. Now we see this strap muscle here. This is the sartorius, the cranial belly. We'll see the caudal belly more on the medial side. Notice it's crossing cranial to the point of rotation of the hip, which is about here. Okay, actually about here. So it's going to flex the hip. We also have this kind of triangular muscle here that's also going to flex the hip. But we see that it is connected to this deep femoral fascia, which is also known as the fascia lata. And so this muscle is known as the tensor fascia lata. So when it tenses that fascia lata, because it merges into the patellar tendon, it's going to extend the stifle. Okay? So we've got this big muscle here. This is the biceps femoris. We have cut it away from its attachment to the deep femoral fascia. Notice these fibers here, if they were to contract, that would tense this fascia lata, also helping in extension of the stifle. But distally, we have these fibers here that are crossing caudal to the point of rotation of the stifle, so they're going to be flexors of the stifle. Okay. Now this muscle also has a connective tissue component that comes down and joins into the common calcanean tendon. Okay. And because of that, it's going to act in extending the hock. So this muscle can extend the hip, which is primary hip extensor, extend the stifle and extend the hock, as in kicking. Okay, during locomotion, when the limb is forward and planted, this muscle is going to act in flexing the stifle, but as the weight passes over, it's going to act in extending the stifle and extending all three of these joints in propulsion. Okay, now if we reflect this muscle, we can see a great big nerve in here. This is the sciatic nerve. It's going to innervate this muscle, and then it's going to divide And we have this portion here, which is the common peroneal nerve, which is going to go to these muscles here. Okay, we'll cover those in a little bit. And then the tibial nerve, which does these more caudal and medial muscles. And we can also see the tibial nerve running adjacent to the common calcanean tendon right here. Okay, so that's the tibial nerve. So we've seen the sciatic, the tibial, and the common peroneal. Okay, concerning these muscles up here, their innervation, we're not going to identify the nerves, but I do want you to know the innervation. The tensor fascia lata, the middle, and the deep gluteal are all innervated by the cranial gluteal nerve. Okay, the superficial gluteal muscle, because it is the most caudal of the gluteal muscles, is going to be innervated by the caudal gluteal nerve. Okay? So what we're seeing here is we have the biceps femoris, the semitendinosus, and the semimembranosus muscle. Okay? These are the hamstring muscles. They're all going to be innervated by the sciatic nerve. These are the primary extensors of the hip. Okay. Come around to the medial side. We can now see that semitendinosus coming down. And it's coming down to attach on the tibia right here. Okay, so it's going to be not just an extensor of the hip, but a flexor of the stifle. It also has a connective tissue component that's going to come down into the common calcanean tendon. Okay, so it's also going to extend the hock. The semimembranosus muscle here, we see, has two bellies. Okay, one belly is going to cross caudal to the point of rotation of the stifle. So it's going to be a flexor. This one is not. It's going to be more proximal. And so this one acts in extending. And how it does that is if you were to have your foot planted and you pull the back of your pants that way, that's kind of how it acts in extending. Okay? So we've got this thin muscle here that we've transected. This is the gracilis muscle. Okay, it's also going to have a component that adds to our common calcanean tendon. Primarily, it's going to be an adductor of the limb. We see here this big, thick muscle. This is the adductor muscle. Guess what the adductor muscle does? That's right, it adducts. And then we have a very small pectineus. So the gracilis, the adductor, and the pectineus are our major adductors of the limb. They're important because we need to keep the limbs up under the body. Okay. Now, they're innervated by the obturator nerve, which as it passes through the pelvic cavity to get to the obturator foramen, is very exposed. In cases of dystocia, especially with cattle, we can damage that nerve. And then these animals, especially when they get on a slippery surface, their legs are going to splay out, and then they can't get back up. Okay? And turn it over, we see that sartorius muscle once again. Here's the cranial belly and the caudal belly. Both of these are going to be flexors of the hip. Notice that this cranial belly is going to merge into the fascia lata here, so it's going to be extensor of the stifle. Whereas the caudal belly passes caudal to the point of rotation, so it's going to be a flexor of the stifle. So let's go to the cranial thigh muscles now. Okay, so we've exposed here the more lateral one. This is going to be the vastus lateralis. Let us go ahead and cut through our fascia lata here. Okay, so here we have transected the deep femoral fascia to expose these cranial muscles of the thigh. And these cranial muscles are known as the quadricep femoris. We see we have a vast one on the lateral side. We'll call that the vastus lateralis. There's a vast one on the medial side, so that's the vastus medialis. And then let's go ahead and transect our rectus femoris muscle here. And then we have, right on the bone, the vastus intermedius. Okay. And then this, as I said, is the rectus femoris. So our vastus muscles attach to the femur, and then they're going to be a part of this tendon here, which contains the patella. And so they're going to be extensors of the stifle. Okay. Likewise, the rectus femoris is also part of that quadriceps extending the stifle. So as a group, these guys extend the stifle. But notice the rectus femoris goes all the way up and attaches to the ilium. So we have the sartorius muscles attaching to the ilium, the tensor fascia latae attaching to the ilium, as well as our rectus femoris attaching to the ilium. So all of these are flexors of the hip. Okay? Now we notice when we transect this, we've got nerve fibers in here going into these muscles. All of our quadricep muscles, as well as the sartorius muscle, are going to be innervated by that nerve, which is the femoral nerve. Okay? So a quick review of our innervation. Our tensor fascia latae, our middle and deep gluteal, are innervated by the cranial gluteal nerve. Our superficial gluteal, it's because it's the most caudal of our gluteal muscles, is innervated by the caudal gluteal nerve. Our hamstring muscles here, the biceps femoris, semitendinosus, semimembranosus, innervated by this big sciatic nerve in here. Let's go back over to this limb, because we can see that better. So that sciatic nerve gives off the common peroneal, which is going to do these cranial lateral muscles that flex the tarsus, and those that have digit in the name also extend the digits. And the tibial, which goes caudally here, dies between the gastrocnemius, is going to do these more caudal muscles back here, which are going to extend the tarsus, and if they have digit in the names, like the superficial and deep digital flexor, they're going to flex the digits. Okay? Now, also what we find caudal to the stifle, we find a lymph node here. This lymph node, because it is caudal to the stifle, is the popliteal lymph node. Okay? So now let's look at these muscles here. So the most cranial muscle on the tibia is the cranial tibial. So the cranial tibial muscle here is going to come down here, and it kind of courses under here, but you can see that it's going to be a flexor of the hock. Okay. Now deep to it here is a muscle that is very similar to the common digital extensor. We see it goes here to all the digits. It's common with the common, but it is longer, so we're going to call it the long digital extensor. Okay. We see a very triangular shaped muscle here whose tendon comes down, and it's going to wrap around this side, and this is going to be the peroneus longus. So it's also just a flexor of these tarsus or hock. Okay. Now that common digital extensor, although it extends the digits, it's going to flex the tarsus. Okay. We have a very small in here lateral digital extensor, which is going to come down and it's going to go to the lateral digits, just as it did in the front. And then here we have the deep digital flexor muscle. We'll see that again on the medial side. Okay, so that's going to extend the hock and flex the digits. Okay, so now caudally on the cruise, we see our deep digital flexor muscle here. We see our superficial digital flexor muscle, this portion kind of buried beneath the gastrocnemius muscle. Okay, so the gastrocnemius is going to come down and attach to the
calcaneus,
but the superficial digital flexor tendon needs to go all the way down. And so what we see here is that their tendons are going to do a little dance here. So we see that of the superficial here and the gastrocnemius here. They do a little twisting right here to get the gastrocnemius tendon deep and then the superficial more superficial. So that superficial digital flexor and that deep digital flexor are going to course down the plantar aspect here. Let's see if we can free those up a little bit. So the superficial and the deep digital flexors are also going to flex the digits as well as extend the hock. Okay. We come around to the medial side here. So on the medial side here, we can see here's more of the gastrocnemius, more of the superficial digital flexor, more of the deep digital flexor. Notice one of its tendons doesn't go through the tarsal tunnel but comes out around this way. And then we've got a muscle that actually originates over on the lateral femur and comes around and attaches kind of fan-like along the tibia here. This is because it goes behind the stifle is the popliteus muscle. Okay, so this is going to have the action of flexing the stifle and also medial rotation. Okay, so the muscles that are on the cranial lateral aspect, so all of these guys here are going to be innervated by that common peroneal, whereas these caudal ones, including the popliteus, are going to be innervated by the tibial nerve. Okay? A concept I want to point out here is if we look at the cranial tibial, it comes around and goes up under here like this. The peroneus longus comes down and wraps around under here. So individually, we're going to see cranial tibial do lateral rotation, the peroneus longus do medial rotation, but working together, they are just going to do nice smooth flexion of the hock. Okay. Likewise, in the front limb, remember, we had this small little muscle here, which is the teres minor. It's going to flex the shoulder from the lateral side. It may cause slight lateral rotation. So therefore, the teres major attaches more on the medial side to flex the shoulder, causing slight medial rotation. Okay, but working together, we're not going to have that rotation. They cancel each other out, so we just get smooth flexion. So often we see muscles that have the same action will attach on different sides of a bone to counter each other's incidental rotary movements. Okay?